Well, this song didn't have a whole lot of variation through it. So, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's Sunday, July 17th, 2016, and we're still at this. So since last time, I upgraded the computer, got 1080 in there. So I had to change because I was using the old one for encoding. I'm still using the old one for encoding, I think. So we'll see how things go. Hopefully there won't be any issues recording. We'll see. So, yeah, we're going to start by launching in. I had a tile open because someone was asking in one of the IRC channels, or actually it's one of the Slack channels for Unreal Engine, how to program something, so I showed him. But I also got to clean up my tabs. That's good. That's good. Leave that there. Don't need that anymore. Don't need that anymore. I'll leave answer hub search up. Why not? Still don't exactly know why things are freezing up, but we'll figure it out later. And so we had new tab search in Unreal Tournament Clean Master and Unreal and a useful reference. I think we've cleaned it up already. Oh no, we got that to get rid of. Good enough. Okay. So let's get into the level. Let's get into the main menu level. So when we start, we have two instances now. The servers can create a game, join a game, or settings. Join a game will just be joining an IP address. Settings will have an actual settings screen, and exits obvious. Whereas a client, when they join in the game, they're going to go to the game lobby, it's connect server, they can modify their settings or exit. So we now need to figure out what all these functionality are, right? So, yep. So here it'll be join or disconnect. Join, disconnect. I'm changing a name. I don't think it'll change the references, but that's the point. Create or to lobby. Settings, same either. So, oh. I was modifying the wrong one. Okay, I have to modify them both anyway. Save, and it probably won't compile. Well, oh well. So I guess I renamed a bunch of these things then. Unpressed to lobby. So what we're going to do instead of what we did last time, well, not the last time, but I mean when we were working on this, is we're going to have this be generic and have whether they spawn in as a client or as a server dictate what they do. So and we'll probably have those be functions because, you know, might as well. So functions, let's say setup. Set up host menu. The one that I want to be set up. I don't want server and client and host and whatever the other one is. Say join. Joiner, I guess. Set post main menu, set joiner main menu. So we're gonna need a new variable. We're gonna have from within main menu. That's not what I want at all. okay. Well, it is what I want, but that's not what I was going for. Set up lobby. Set host lobby menu. Set up joiner lobby menu. And here we're gonna have a variable that would be the widgets. What do we call it again? Screen create game. Screen create game, there we are. Reference. Lobby screen. And that'll be private, I don't want anything modifying it except this. Hi, welcome to the chat. Well, I normally don't say people's names until they talk in chat, but Chakma has talked quite a few times in the past, so. Hello, Chakma. Okay, so event graph back here. So, for the lobby widget, we're going to do a create widget. Oh, I forgot how to do it now. We're only executes on a client, even if the server is the client. Widget only on client user. Actually look at multiplayer shootout, see what it does. I'm not sure if it actually has this use case, but we'll see. So it doesn't make a change based on server clients, even though that's not what we do either, but... Okay, so here we have play, find games, quit, internet mode, and here we have... Okay, so that's there. Well, they made some errors. That's good to know. It's always so easy until you actually realize what you're doing. right. Blueprints. Come on. Oh, I could do the breadcrumb trail there. There we are. Game instance. Yeah, I'm monitoring your chat. Hello. A knowledge. So I may be a little bit slow because I'm, you know, programming and talking at the same time, so. But no, I do watch chat. Yep. Okay. How long does it take me? Well, this right here is Epic's demo. This is mine here. We've been working on that for a long time, but we've been working on it kind of in stages. Yeah, sure, why not? Here, so we... didn't work. So the blueprint won't compile. Let's load up an older version. It's over here. Good. Okay. So what we were working on. Is. This game right here. It's similar to chess. Except that it's not on. It's on design levels. So. This is only, that's the wrong one. I thought that was a built one that I did for, whatever. Okay, well, I guess I'll show you the one from last year then. So, this is a game jam we're working on last year. We ended up taking, most of the rest of the year for it. 1 second while it loads up. So this looks like chess, except that there's multiple levels. So this is another level. When it loads up, There we are. Gonna do a bunch of loading and stuff like that, because it's, I guess, a new graphics card. So, player spawns here with a queen and a king. There's knights in the stable because haha horses. Then there's two bishops there, and over in the corner here is another queen, more rooks, and the AI spawns down over here in front of this bridge. So it's you know, spawn versus spawn. Let's actually see what I'm running at right now. Okay, over 200 frames per second. Okay. So anyway, you have to be in control by being within range of the king, or if I expand it beyond regular chess pieces, whatever piece has control. Currently it's only the king, but there may be like a prince or a princess or some other piece that I'll add later on as a booster. But as you see, I can select the knights. When I move the king back, I no longer can, so I can't select this. I can select this guy, but I can't select this guy. It actually deselects when I try to select them. Anyway, so that was all broken. Like, the code was really bad. It was made in the game jam, so we did a refresh here. And we were trying to figure out some problems, but we think we broke the project file, so we created a new project when we, because it wouldn't port over to 4.12, so we created a new project 4.12. But this is the one in the original one. It's a bit more open, so it wasn't just one versus AI. The level could be set up in any way I want, really. So in this case, I want to have AI spawn 1 and player spawn 2. There's only 2 spawns this map, despite there being 10 up here, because unfinished UI. When we launch in the game, then we have access to all these pieces, or these pieces, and the opponent has that. They decide to move one queen out, which is okay, because I'm just going to kill their king. And I just won the game. But, yeah. Let's kill the queen. So that's the game there. And now we're working on reprogramming it. Epic Launcher still wants to lock up. I don't know what its problem is. Anyway, so we're working on that now, and we're trying to get a... compile, which ones don't work? Oh, okay, yeah. And we're trying to get this going. Screen create game. Create widget. We're going to get player controller. 0, because for some reason that's what they do. And then we're going to do a set. This here. It's not replicated, so it'll be only on the client or server that runs it. And what do I do normally? So I create the widget and I add the viewport. I'm gonna have that be done in the Actually, no, let's have input be a player controller. So, base player controller. And we'll call it player controller. So I don't have to use this, just in case for some reason I'm going to want to have it be create with not just the first person. I don't know why I would, but started getting the code, and I gotta say, he lost me when with all the talk about breaking the code. Yeah, sorry about that. Screen create game. Screen lobby. This is probably a bad way of doing it, but you know what? We're gonna do it that way, so why not? How long I've been coding? Depends on when you want to start counting. I started when I was like, 12 or 13, but that was like, text-based games that I played a lot. Where, so the interesting thing about some of these text-based games is they were based on a Telnet client, which is basically like a chat type client. But they would send, using like text art, like maps and stuff like that. So you'd actually be playing a top-down strategy game. But everything was sent through text commands. So we'd end up having like, on the number pad, we'd have it set up so we press, this one, it was, heading 0, heading 60 degrees, heading 90 degrees, heading, 120 degrees, heading 180 degrees. And you would turn your, it was actually based on Battletech, like MechWarrior, so it would turn your mech around. And the plus and minus was speed and stuff, so we were playing that, but it was all in the text-based. And one of the nice things about it was that the player was programmable. So, if you wanted to automate some tasks that, were, useful, without spamming up your screen, because it would all happen on the server side and just give you the answer, you could call commands and like do text manipulation to grab chunks of text from it, connect it to a string, and do whatever you want with it. So I create a, it was kind of motivation to create, so there's a guy before me, I think his name was Mav, I could be wrong though, who created a function that you type in A for channel A because it radios. So you radio channel A, and it was con, and then the target, and it would actually look for the target ID, get all the information, like how damaged they are, where they are, what they're headed, and stuff like that, and send it out through the radio communication one. So you just type in like six letters and 67 characters, and it would say where you are. And I was like, well, that's kind of interesting, but I would like to have it for position. So I, one of the first major things I programmed was a command that got some navigation and tactical commands in the background, and was just like pulling words from it and compiling it to a radio message and sending it out for where you are and what your status is. So I call it Hex Me because it was a hex grid game. Sorry, all the tiles were hexagon on the map. Yeah, so that was one of the first things I did, is I programmed that for people to broadcast where they are, and I just gave it out for free on the public board. So a bunch of people did it, and the funny thing about that that thing was, I was just learning, I'm like, I want to learn how to program right? I want to program good. This is the 90s, by the way. I want to learn how to program good, right? So I was like, oh, people want to comment, so I commented all my code all over the place, like, every little line that was, and it was basically all one line, you kind of sent in one paragraph, but you had, I'm not sure what language you use, but like, if you do like JavaScript or something, if you do a semicolon, it interprets as a new line, even though it's still one line. Similar idea. And I was commenting each chunk of that, and, then one day the server admin logged in and complained to me because apparently, I did not know this at the time, apparently the comments, because it's not a compiled language, it's applied, like it's text you apply to the character, and each time it calls an event, it looks like text, runs it like JavaScript as a, you know, just-in-time, like, you know, script, and does it. And apparently that, you know, does it, because it's not compiled, parses out comments at runtime. So every time you put a comment in, it actually takes a server tick just to, you know, just to omit it, right? And it turns out that my command was pretty popular. So the guy came in to complain to me because his Pentium 1 133 megahertz server had a noticeable amount of server processor time, CPU time, omitting comments in my very popular command. So he was not very happy with me. But yeah, so that was one of the first things I programmed back in the 90s. From there, I mean, I was doing like some game mods. I really didn't take it seriously until after university, though. I went through university for physics. So I set the lobby there, and now I need to do the... Yeah. So now the problem is we need to make sure that elements that are host only are only editable by the host. So we need to have some variable of some sort, which we'll put on here, I guess. I sound like a legend, no. Nope. I've been doing it for a while, but you know, like I haven't really made any money off of anything I've programmed before. I shouldn't say that. I have done some stuff, but it was, you know, it was for places that I've already been hired to do other things for. I don't think I've ever sold anything. Not that I remember of. I mean, I'm probably forgetting something very simple, but yeah. Okay, so I don't want to do this. Because I'm already storing this on the controller. So event tick, get player controller. And then it'll be cast base player controller. So what we're doing here is every tick we're getting the player controller that is looking at this, and we are converting it to a base player controller. And the reason why I'm doing that is because in base player controller I have a variable or is it player state? Oh, it's player state actually. Oh yeah, it's base player state called menu host. So I'll have to change that. When someone's a menu host, so there's two things here. So when you're talking about multiplayer, you're typically talking about server and client. So server is whoever owns the instance of the game. The player that is on the state that's on the box, right? That's actually running the game. And everyone else is clients. Everyone else just asks the server to play, asks the server what to do. And a server is the entity that says, yes, it can work, yes, it cannot. So for multiplayer games, you want everything to be done on the server and all the clients just to ask for it. Well, we have a second issue right now where we have the host as well, which is not the same as the server at all. So the host could be just a player, could be a server, we don't know. There could be a player and a server, and a host is a different player anyway, we don't know. But the host is the person who is responsible for setting who spawns where, setting team names, setting, you know, or whatever. setting up teams, setting up spawns, map, game mode. So the person who creates the game, right? Since they could be different people, or different, like one of them, like the server doesn't have to have a person associated, but could be a dedicated server. Since they're different people, we have to track them separately. So this chunk right here is a true or false value that I'm saying, if you are the host, you're there. If server, we'll just use Unreal Engine's way of controlling who's server because I don't want to track that. Why would I? Like, it has a really good way of doing it. Why not just use it, right? But for this, I want to track the menu separately, so I'm going to be checking to see if they are the host. So that way, when they play the game, right, when they create the round, we don't have, you know, someone trying to set a map in mode, and someone else trying to set a map in mode, and someone else trying to set a map in mode, and someone trolling and setting, you know, random maps in mode, and this game never gets created. We want to have one person set it, and everyone else just take the settings or disconnect, right? So we're doing that from the player states. I will close multiplayer shootout because I don't think I need it anymore for the time being. There we are. So let's do get player state. So get player controller. And we'll do cast or get player state. Then we'll do a cast. Oh, whoops. It's not pawn, we want player controller, get player state. There we are, this is the one we want. So I just do games? No. One second. Base player state. So we're gonna cast place player state. So we're gonna get the player controller, we're gonna get the player state off of it. And then we're going to get that, then we're going to return it. There we are. So return base player state. Reference there. Bingo. Okay. So I can grab this and this, get rid of that, just do get player states. Yeah. Oh, and I need to set return node. So I do just do games? No. I've also done yeah, it's old Monster Cat, so it's pretty dubsteppy. This song is from Stephen Walking, Monster Cat 4, song number 9, Strong Arm. So Stephen Walking, Strong Arm. Okay, and that's that, so that's good. Save there. So now we can go back to our event graph. Get player state, that's us. Oh, is this the wrong one I'm trying to do? Oh no, that's right, okay, so yeah, I also do web development and stuff like that. So I'm gonna try to do whatever I can, really. I also had to do some scientific programming in physics when I was in my degree. My thesis was computational. It was simulating like going through a photonic crystal, which basically is it was in the theoretical side of things, so it wasn't like actually making a crystal. But the idea is that a photonic crystal is completely opaque. You can't see through it. But if you add a defect in it that resonates at a certain frequency, a certain color, you can shine that color in it, and it will penetrate to that thin hole. And then if you create multiple of them, you can transfer a larger band of light, like a waveguide, like a fiber optic, but in an actual crystal. And the idea behind that, why it's so interesting, is because you can then route light however you want, because if you can make it go in a straight line, you can make it go in whatever angle you want. Well, if you can make it, you know, go through a path, you can do whatever you want with a path, is what I should say. You can't necessarily bend light, even though, and you basically have it, like, leak from node to node to node, and that creates a circuit. And now when you have a photonic circuit, then you can create an integrated circuit, which would be a, which would have, like, logic and memory and stuff like that. So it would be useful for computers. Whenever we get out of silicon electronics using radio waves, next step, well, one possible next step up would be photonic crystals. So you'd actually have, you know, instead of hundreds of megahertz to gigahertz radio waves, you would have hundreds of terahertz light waves that would be routed through the circuit. And obviously higher frequency, you can do more. You won't have, you know, an effective clock of 100 terahertz. You have to kind of group things together. We can't operate on a single wavelength of light. We have to make groups of them. But it still has the potential of being much faster than silicon, and also lower heat as well. So you're actually able to make them 3D if you want. So if you have right, if you're not restricted by heat, if you have light going forward and you can make it go left or right, you can also make it go up or down too, right? So you can make some interesting circuits that way, which could be useful for electronics whenever we run out. There was UC Boulder. Last Christmas, they made a electronic circuit that had a photonic section of it that just did input-output, but still, they're able to integrate a photonic crystal onto a silicon semiconductor. So that's kind of cool. So we get player state. I don't want to deal with cost. Okay. I was looking to see if there's some way we can make it kind of static. Because it's, you know, doesn't matter for the instance. We're not doing it on an instance. Unless this is what a macro should be for. Oh, okay. I mean, that's why we should use macro instead. Player state. I was wondering why Epic did it, but then I'm thinking, oh, maybe it's because inputs, not outputs. New param. Player states. How do you do? It was very interesting. Maybe I will need it right now. That's weird. It's causing the launcher to crash, lock up. So that's when the launcher is locking up. It's when I run on the first shootout. Interesting. Okay, so I'm gonna take a brief intermission. So I will be right back, but I'm gonna be on a break for a second. 1 second.
Thank you.
And I'm back. Sorry about that. Other peeps here. There is four people in the chat. Three, including you. Okay, so we're back to this. So, so I'm not exactly sure what I'm doing when it comes to, like, macros and stuff like that. So let's see if that's what I want. So it's current state. Okay, so input here. You have control. Oh, exec. Okay, we need to actually say it's an executable input. Okay. So we need to add a input execution. And we will add a or display state, and we'll be base player state. In and out and out. Okay, so get. Why didn't it like that? Screen creating failed. Oh, okay. So that's function's gone. Alright. There we are. Now we need our function, which we're gonna call is host. And then we'll do get player state. And branch bmenu host. Get menu host. So is a target. Menu host, if true, return node, and we'll have an output be true. Is host. And then return. And nodes copy it, so it's false. So simple little node gets a player state using the macro, and if they're a host, actually you can just return it. Save the computation, so return. Is host. There we are. Even simpler little node, which just returns whether they the current player on this machine, be it server or client, is the host. So now in the event graph, on every tick, is host. Why do I need to use target self? We need a new macro instead, so it's host. Oh yeah, get rid of that, okay, so. When will I learn, apparently? In and new X out, and then we'll add a new one here, which will be boolean is host. No. So that way in here, do is host and not have that instance thing. And I could just hide the pin probably, but still. Thanks for watching. So if is host, we're gonna do a branch. On condition here, then if true, we're going to do we allow editing. So if true, we're going to enable all of the menu items. If not, we're going to disable them. So, so we're going to end our macro. Set control. Not set, show host options, call it show hide host options, sure, why not? Okay, X. Why did I do that? I think I accidentally clicked the wrong macro. Is that a little double click? Skip restore. Don't restore. Some blueprints. Oh, no, we want UI. Create game. So let's see what I have left. Oh, no. So is host is works. Player state doesn't. Let's go. I don't like sets. Show hide works, but it's kind of verbose. Now we had a crash, we can think of whatever we want to have another one. What we call it?
I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat. From outside this world.
All right, this one. Okay. We'll call this. And we'll call it toggle. update. Update, host settings. There we are. That's the right word. Okay. So now we need new values, both execute to allow the flow to come through. So in, out. So now in the designer, we have to think of what would we would need to disable. So this is an obvious one. So the two drop downs, disabled as well as the launch button. Yeah. So two drop downs and the launch button are definitely going to be changed. So drop down map. Drop down mode. And button launch. And we'll do set is enabled button launch. Event craft, what I do is host. So input as well, a new one for Boolean. We'll do is host. Reroute. Reroute node. And then we will add another reroute node. Now we'll do another set is enabled. Will be the drop down map. And then here, set is enabled. Should be relatively good for now, just to test it. Then route. Oops, no, all right. That's right, because I get rid of that. So we'll do update host settings, then is host. That should be good. Now what we really should do is check to see if it's already been set and not reset it, because that might cause some issues with changing the values, but we'll see. Oops, that won't work. Need to be on the right level. There we are. Get on my level. No. There we are. So in the server, click Handles Lobby, and here we are. In the client, it's not disabled. That's weird. So let's create a breakpoint here. And then go through here. Tick. Step into. Set as enabled. And we'll have here, we'll do print. And we'll do, there we are. Let's actually have a bit longer. Let's have it be 4 seconds. Even though it's gonna matter because it's gonna be on ticks, it's gonna scroll through the screen anyway, but. Oh, I need to get rid of the breakpoint. Breakpoint. Zoom. So, clients, true. And if we're on a server, true. So for some reason, the client thinks it's a server as well, host as well. Did we forget to check that? The screen main menu is the one that does that. So in server request, new player controller. All right, because there's only one player controller. Is that correct? Yeah, only one player controller. Two player states, but only one controller. So UE4, one player controller PIE. Could do is we could possibly or likely crash our game and try it with multi-process. Pretty sure this still crashes the game. We'll see. Yeah, so this is locked up, but. Even then, it's still true. And now our server's locked up. Launcher's not locked up though, so that's a good sign. So base where it says starts default false. Restore. Okay, so on main menu, what we're gonna do is we're gonna see how many player controllers we have. So on tick, we'll do print string, and then for each. And then get all element or actors of class. Oops, needs to have control too, I guess. Hard to tell which gets require control, which ones don't. And the class would be base player controller. Probably even for each. Print string num length there. So there we are, get all its class, print string. It'd be helpful if I launched it correctly in the right way without crashing the game, which is kinda hard. Wait, did it not crash? No, it's crashed. She's locked up. We need to figure out what's going on with the use single process before we do anything else. Let's put it on use single process. Save all, and then go main menu. Is this been saved? Yeah. Okay. Some levels. Main menu. Main menu. So it's only seeing one player controller. K4, use single process, one player controller. Game instance, so you game instance. We'll eventually try all possibilities until we get one that works, right? Let's see, local players. Local player. So why are we only spawning one player controller? Actually, you know what? Let's stop for a second, and let's figure this out after we restart Epic Launcher, because for some reason it wants to crash all the time. Let's go back Epic Launcher, and let's look at the examples and see what they have. I think I'm hoping to have a second multiplayer example. I don't think they do though. Does your game have multiplayer? Not sure, let's create one. It's on my data drive. So while we're downloading that, let's try doing one for multiplayer shootout. So I'm not exactly sure why Epic Launcher freezes up, but hopefully it won't. Okay, it didn't lock up good. It's our game instance. So we run two instances in the same server. We look over here and we see that it has two camera actors, two gunslingers. There's one player controller though. There's two characters. So maybe what I gotta do is get the pawn. So let's look here. So you local player, get controller ID, get game instance. Oh, sorry. So you local player, what does you local player have? So what we really need to do is we need to find out how to is player state or get player state associated with viewport. Because, I mean, you could do that with player controller, but the player controller is only returning one, even though there's two. So the way I was planning on doing it was get player controller zero, and then associate with player state, but apparently that's for all of them. Let's run this and we'll see what's going on. One thing I want to do is I want to see if we do get player controller, get player state, which one it will return. Main menu, is this where we do it? Yeah, got it. Player controller, then four each. Just in case for some reason it decides to have multiple. Array element, player states. Return and then print. Length. So compile, save. Let's see if this works. Of course, it won't work because we're not on that level. The base player state one. So then, we'll run that kiss, and we'll see here. So player state zero. So confusing. Clients is base player state one. Oh, I should also, so the server doesn't have a player state. Player controller. So why doesn't the server have a player controller? Am I set up wrong? My project set up stupidly? Maybe this is the problem. So I'm still playing as a client. So when I click here, it still says client. So apparently I still have a lot more to look up, so I'm gonna look up on it and I'll get back to you guys all next time. So thanks for watching. See y'all next time.